So yeah, the idea was to bring some, share with you how data protection has been working in Argentina for a long time now, show you where we are, where we ambition to be shortly, and it's good that Isabel was first because we are following the European steps in terms of data protection, so many of the things she shared with you I will just go over and repeat. One quick disclaimer is that this presentation that you will receive a copy has many, many slides that we are not going to cover. So every time I pass one or the other, it's not that I'm lazy. It's because we don't have the time. I have 20 minutes to share things with you. And I would like to concentrate more in the bill that we are discussing now and maybe the experience we have, good and bad, of course, and how we, you know, how the Argentinian experience can help you when you think in Brazil about data protection and in the region. So a little, okay. Which goes back? Okay, so a little bit, well, we have an evidence right, a constitutional right in the constitution, which was amended in 1994 for a long time. We didn't see much. You can imagine 1995 was far away and people were not thinking a lot about data protection. Then it was complemented in the year 2000 with data protection law, just to put you a little bit on what was going on there. We had in Argentina a specific problem with credit report companies, which were providing reports and they were not doing their job. So when you, even if you pay your debt, you will be there for forever. And so people were struggling to have credit to buy a house or buy a car. So the idea of the law in 2000 was just to make sure that these credit reports would delete data after some time. And with that in mind, of course, many of the things we are discussing today, we have to discuss with the law which was meant for that in 2000. And you, as you can imagine, things in 2000 were very different in terms of technology and how data was. Most of the databases that we can remember at that time were paper-based, so there were no computers or servers as we know them today, which makes it very difficult for us who practice data protection law to apply the law in some of the different scenarios that we see today. So it was complemented with a regulatory decree a year after that. And then something that it's important in what we are discussing today. In 2002, Argentina was recognized by the European Union and as providing an adequate level of protection in terms of data flow. So for a long time until now, if you are based in the EU, you can transfer data to Argentina back and forth free. Now you don't need a contract, you don't need consent, you don't need much of the things that you would need otherwise. So it has been very important, and that's just something that we are going to discuss at the end of how it helped our industry. So as I said, the primary goal was addressing ongoing credit report companies. We have many information that is going to be here, definitions about what data protection, personal data treatment that are very, very similar to what you will find in the EU. And even if I remember, okay, from my last visit to Brazil in June, about how things work here, there are definitions that are very similar to what you will understand. So I don't want to get a long time there. So something that is kind of, I wouldn't say unique, but it's very difficult to find worldwide is we have a registration requirement. So in order to be licit to treat data, the first thing that you have to do is to inform the DPA that you have a database. That would be the first step. And you don't have, of course, to show the data, but you have to say, I have a database with, I don't know, the records of my employees, my contractors, my partners, my clients, etc. That would be new. The key to start processing data in a lawful manner, then complemented by some other things. But this is something that we don't see much, so many of our clients struggle about why would I inform them that I have the database, and this is something that's gonna change in the near future, we will see. But up to now, if you plan to do business in Argentina and you would like to comply with the law, you have to register any database that you have. As to the quality of data, of course, it's very, very obvious. It has to be accurate, adequate, pertinent, and not excessive. This comes to data retention. This comes to the data subject rights. If the information is incomplete, They have the right to request to be completed, and if they have wrong information, it has to be amended, etc. This is very typical, the same things that we have in the EU. As to information, before you are able to process data, you have to inform the data subject of many of the things. The existence of the database, who is controlling the database, what's the purpose of the collection of the data, and what you're intending to use, if you plan to share the information with somebody. Some of the things today sounds very obvious. It was not that in 2000, I guess. But this is what you expect. We are all consumers. When you take your council hat, you are a consumer, and you expect that people will tell you what they're doing with your data, and you would like to have a say. We can discuss what kind of say we would like to have, but this is what you would expect. In terms of consent, if you want a takeaway of what's going on in Argentina, and I guess in many countries of the region, consent is the principle. If you want to treat data, you have to get informed, prior, free consent from the data subject. That will give you access to practically do whatever you need to do, as long as the data subject has been informed. There are some exceptions of what you cannot do, even with consent, and we will see that in a minute. But that's the principle you have to take, consent. And in some cases, like for example, when you get to marketing communications, we have adopted a different approach there. It's an opt-out. So you can send communications, for example, if you are a bank and you want to send them some information about new services that you're providing, you have to give them the chance to opt out and take them out from the list, but you can actually send the communication without having first the consent. There are some exceptions, which are the ones which are more important to what we do every day, is the those that derives from a contractual relationship. So if you get into a relationship with a data subject, and there's a contract between you and him or her, it is obvious that you can collect the data you need just for the purpose of the contract, so you don't need to get a special separate consent. And there's some other exceptions which are not very broad, but for example, if you just collect name, ID, tax, or social security number, occupation, and date of birth, and even address, you can do that without consent. But of course, you don't have the phone number or email there, which are more likely to be the information that you want to have from a data subject to do business. Sensitive data, which is understand of data that reveals, for example, sexual orientation or affiliation to a political party, so on. That is the gray area that we have today. It says that you cannot treat data even with the consent of data subject. So this has been creating a lot of problems during 17 years now. When you want, for example, to get criminal background checks or things alike, in principle, you do not have the authority to process this data, even if you have consent from the data subject. So it's an area that you have to find creative solutions if you want. Of course, there's a duty of confidentiality along all the chain of processing the data. We do not have a specific provision in terms of data retention. General principle would be that when the data is not needed for the purpose it was collected, you have to delete it. Correct me if I'm wrong, no one deletes any data. So I haven't seen many cases brought to the courts, but the truth is that when you talk to clients and you say, do you delete the data when, the data subject or the user of your service deactivates the account or is no longer doing business for a long time, the answer will be no. So that is something that we have to, and it's addressed in the bill. As to security of the data, we live with a regulation which was issued in 2006 with a different world. Data breaches were kind of different. So there are very basic security obligations that we have in the data protection law, which almost all companies would comply because they are very, very standard and very simple. They are rethinking about having a new directive that would give a little bit more strength to this. Of course, there was no breach notification in 2000. No one was thinking about the Fairfax or any, you name it, any company you want, data breaches, these big data breaches that we are seeing every day. Personally, we have an understanding that if you put in place the civil code, and now we have a civil and commercial code, we superseded the civil code. we have an obligation, companies, individuals have an obligation to prevent damage. So if you are aware that there was an incident or a breach, and you know for, you know, there's a, you can figure out that people are gonna get harmed because of that, we think that there is still an obligation. We are not sure how and what would be the case. We are not the core decisions that will give some light on that. But it's something to take into consideration, and it's something that we're going to change if we have this build, and I'm going to show you after. So you can assign data with consent. That is very simple. In terms of international transfer, is what I said. So you cannot, it's forbidden to transfer data to any country which does not provide an adequate level of protection, unless, and then you have the EU, because it's adequate, or if you have the consent, you have a DTA, a data transfer agreement, which provides kind of the same level of protection that we have in Argentina, or you have self-regulation. As to the data transfer agreement, we will see in the following slides that there's a regulation specific for that that comes with two model clauses, two model contracts for data transfer. One is for data processing, just simple like that, and the other one is the assignment of the data per se. If you use one of these two for this purpose, then you are good to go. If you use a different model and you feel that you are complying with the law, you're good to go too. Before that, you have to get counsel to see the contract. And if you think that it's not that simple, then you have a 30-day window in which you have to file a contract for approval with the DPA. This is very recent, and we haven't seen many cases about that. Data subject rights are the ARCO rights, so access, rectification, cancellation, and opposition. This is very, very straightforward. And then there's a, if you go to any company and you try to access the data they have, there's a 10-day they have to comply with. After that, you are enabled to go to a court and request this before a judge. In terms of sanctions and fines, what you see there are the range that we see of different remedies and sanctions. In terms of when it comes to monetary compensation, it is very low. As you can see there, the figures in dollars. It is expected that this will get go a little bit up. We don't have the EU approach in this 2% turnover global thing. So what it means in practice is that companies are not very threatened about sanctions. When they ask, what if I don't comply, and you explain, these are the kind of fines that you can see, and it doesn't seem very deterrent. But as we will see, this might be changing in the near future. So let's go to what is new. So we have a bill that was discussed with the private sector a lot. The DPA actually wrote this first draft, then we discussed this among the community, civil society, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody was given the chance to say something. It resembles a lot the GDPR coming into force in Europe. It was written in one way. Many people gave very valuable comments about what was going on, and then they published a second draft, which took many of these ideas into the text. Why are we changing, or why DPA proposed this change, is because what it says here, you know, technological advances. I always have like a list here. In 2000, you didn't have Wikipedia, Uber, Gmail, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Amazon Web Services, iPod, Google Maps, Skype, iPhone, Google Docs, Waze, you name it. So the different world in which we are living make it really necessary to have different approach. And I'm particularly, and if I speak for myself, and not for the, if you want for Marwal, I think that you should find a way to protect people and to let the companies do business. So this is the world we live today. I like my privacy to be protected, but at the same time, sometimes I feel that they are overprotecting us as consumers or users. You know, we don't have a consumers association to have a say and say, you know, the trade-off in giving my information so that I have a better service, I'm okay with that. I can live with that. So every time we see this balance in between, you know, this would affect privacy or data protection of individuals. We don't really see how people would actually want their data to be protected. It's always specialists, if you want, discussing this. And that's a disaggregation of my own. And then it's a practical experience gained by the DPA during the time. And of course, it's GDPR. And this has to do with, as I said, we have been recognized as adequate country by the EU. That has allowed a lot of business to come to Argentina. We know for a fact of clients of ours that have came because in other countries of the region, they didn't have the same flexibility to, for example, open the data centers assistance to consumers. You could put that down in Argentina with good human resources, reasonable prices for their wages, and you have this flow of data that was very important at the time. One aspect that really, really would change with the draft bill is that we are going to have, or we do have, the Agencia Nacional de Protección de Datos, which is a new body created, which would be in charge of the access to public information, actually, and then they were giving very recently the duty to be the controlling authority for the data protection law. And this is an autonomous and decentralized agency. This is something that when we were recognized as an adequate country, the EU said, okay, everything is right, but the director of data protection agency depends from a ministry, and he can remove one day or the other just by a presidential decree. And we don't like this. That's not independent in the way we think it should be. And so this responds a little bit to that. So I don't have much time going further. You know, the definitions of the law are very similar to the ones we have today. For example, sensitive data is a little bit broader, but it's just the same. It comes with data breach, data security breach as a definition, and that's because we have an obligation now, or we could have an obligation. This is a huge, also this is a huge step forward in terms of the territorial scope. Today, Argentine law is clear that it works if you have servers or you provide services in Argentina. It's a gray area. If you are, say, a Netflix and you provide services from abroad, you don't have the service in Argentina. Even if you collect data from Argentine citizens, whether the laws in Argentina would apply. Well, the bill is much more clear about that. And so even if you operate from a third country and you don't have service in Argentina, but you do collect data from citizens in Argentina, the similar approach you have in the EU, Argentine data protection law would apply. The question is, who will enforce it? Who will go to California, the DPA to California, to enforce a ruling? We don't see it happening, but this is something that is going to be there. When it comes to resources, as any other Latin American country, you can imagine that the DPA has not deep pockets, and so it's very difficult for them to pursue. They normally get like a big case that would get to the media, and following that case, give an example to the market, but it's not much. In terms of the principles, are very similar to what we have today, except for we have accountability, as Isabel was saying. We are not anymore having this registration requirement, so we're going to get to, you will have to document how you process data, and in the day we knock at the door, you have to show the DPA how you have been doing and why you say you comply. Show me how, show me your software, show me your documentation, show me there were no data breaches. You have to be more proactive than what we are today. In terms of consent, this is something new. There's a possibility of having implicit consent, something that we don't have today. We have express consent. You will have the chance you have an implicit consent. And it goes a lot to the internet, I guess, to things that we do online, we do our phones. The fact that you use and you give different, there's some other ways in which, and I think it's a good approach. There's some other ways in you can give your consent. This is related to consent of minors. Up to today, if you are under 18, you need to have consent from parents. So many companies have decided not to, you know, target kids because it was very difficult to get their consent of their parents. So now, if there are services that are directed to this group, 13 to 17, they can consent themselves, which. I found difficult to see what services are directed to kids when younger people, not myself, but younger people, but all the people would play the same games that kids are playing. So Pokemon Go, I can imagine kids for 13 years old, and then all of us here, you know, chasing the Pokemon. So it's, you know, definitions of directed to kids, it's like, I don't know. You have to be reviewed. The new rights, we have the right to be forgotten, which we actually had on the law, but now it's better explained. We have data portability that Isabel was talking about, so you have the chance to go from one provider to the other. Sensitive data, it's a little bit broader, but it's just the same idea. But the thing is, now you can consent to the use of your sensitive data. So the data subject now has the right to do that, and that would be very, very important for companies doing business in Argentina with sensitive data, now that we have these wearables, watches or cell phones, and they collect data, and then if you go to, you know, they treat data, medical data, and for some time it was a very gray area, but now it's gonna be much clearer. The protection, when it's a little shift, now you have to do more than what you were doing. You have to see, okay, what kind of data am I treating? Is it sensitive? Are there any breaches in this industry that I might take into consideration? So what the law is doing is putting in the companies more, more the initiative, if you want, to do more to show that they are complying with the law. And so if you decide to use very specific data that it presents a risk to the subject, you will be asked to do more. There's a data breach notification, which is exactly the same as the EU, so I don't want to use any more minutes, which I don't have. We have a DPO also. It is important that it is mandatory if you are a public agency, so any public agency we have would need to have a DPO. Also, if you treat sensitive data, again, if you undertake big data, something that we have been discussing in the other panel, if you do big data, and we have to define what big data is, you also need to have a DPO. International transfer is similar to what we have today. The only thing that is good for business is that if you are part of the economic group, you can share information within the group, and that would be fine. Of course, the group has to have a treatment and a process of the data is compatible with the law. Nothing changes here. There's an impact analysis. So in some cases, you will need to go for an impact analysis if and it's described there. If it poses a high risk for the data subject, anything you plan to do, then you have to do that before you are able to. Many of the things that we are talking today, there's a lot of information that we are missing. We expect that once the law, and if it is passed into law, there's going to be a decree that would regulate many of these gray areas that we can't define, which is pose a high risk. We are all lawyers, and we could argue for, you know, days about what it is and what it is not, but we need to have something more, you know, more tangible to make sure that we understand. Fines can get up to a maximum of 250,000. That gets a little bit more color, I guess. And then there's the possibility of bringing class action is expressed in the law. So I leave these open questions, and maybe, I guess, Paulo, we want to discuss at the end of what we can learn in Argentina, what we can do better, what we need to be changed, and what are the teachings we see from our mistakes and that can benefit the region in general. Thank you.